I believe with complete faith in the coming of Mashiach. This is a fundamental tenet of Jewish belief. On a train to Treblinka, a lone voice began to hum what has since become a world-famous melody. It was none other than the angelic voice of Reb Azriel David Fastag, the chief cantor in the court of the great Rebbe of Mozhit. Composed as the train was rattling down the tracks, Rebbe Azriel proclaimed and promised, "Whoever will take this song and share it with my saintly Rebbe will receive half of my share in the world to come." Two young boys stepped forward and promised at all costs to preserve the melody and share it with the Rebbe. A hole was bored into the roof of the cattle car, and they both jumped off the train. One was met with instant death, and the other survived the war, sharing it with the Rebbe. Upon seeing the musical notes and hearing the melody, the Rebbe of Mozhit proclaimed, "When they sang this melody on the death train, the pillars of the world were shaking." The Almighty said, "Whenever the Jews will sing Ani Ma'amin, I will remember the 6 million victims and have mercy on the rest of my people." Please give your attention to this very rendition of Ani Ma'amin. So much, Rayan. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to Critical Conversations with Esther Basch. Esther, as you know, is a survivor of the Auschwitz death camps, sent there in a cattle car on her 16th birthday. So to be able to hear from a survivor, a live witness, is a tremendous privilege and honor, and of course speaks to the tremendous dedication of Esther. I have to say, seeing you, Esther, on the podium of our show gives me immense pleasure. It puts chills down my spine. And I know our community and the greater community is all the better for it. I also want to make mention that this evening, Esther's grandson is here and a great-grandson is here. And that itself speaks volumes for the community. Esther, Esther shares her story for others to learn not only the horrors, but also how to live a full life of love and forgiveness. This is her first visit to Connecticut. And I have to tell you that I asked her the question. I said, what motivates you when you tell this story? And she says, when she says this, tells the story and she sees the interest that people have in her story and in the history and in the Holocaust, it takes a load off her heart. And actually, she said, it lessens her nightmares that she has at night. And so, not that I think that we've done her a service in this evening, but I do want to say that I wanted to thank you all for coming. And of course, just to underscore the tremendous respect it is for the Holocaust survivors. And of course, we don't have them, we will not have them forever, but to able to be, to hear it, you know, firsthand is really something very special. Esther, I want to thank you for coming and welcome. We look forward to hearing your story.
Thank you so much for having my childhood.
Yeah,
I was born in the Carpathian Mountains, which when my mom was born, it was Hungary. And when I was born in the same house, it was Czechoslovakia. And then in 1938, the Hungarians came back. And then in 1942, the Nazis took over, and that was the end of the Jewish population. We had to wear a yellow Star of David right away next day. And when I went into the school and the teacher saw the star, threw me out and said, you're a dirty Jew. You're not allowed to have any higher education. I went home crying because actually I liked school. I liked to learn, but it was just not possible when the Nazis came in. We were tortured mercilessly for 2 years, and after 2 years, we were taken into a ghetto, which was like made four streets, a square, and they put all the Jewish people in there, not only from our hometown, but from around the vicinity. And so they were tortured mercilessly. Before they came, I had a wonderful childhood, climbing the Carpathian Mountains, playing with all my friends, Jewish friends, Christian friends. But when the Nazis came in, all of a sudden I'm a dirty Jew. At age 14, I did not understand how I was clean yesterday and today I'm dirty. And it went on like that for 2 years. When they put us into the ghetto, actually, they put us into a house right across from my house. And we were watching how the neighbors from the right was taking everything from us. The cattle, the geese, the chickens, everything. But the neighbor from the left risked his life to come out and call out my father's name and throw over a piece of bread over the fence. If he would have been caught, he would have been killed on the spot. but he risked his life because he knew we were starving. And this went on for 6 weeks, being tortured mercilessly. And after 6 weeks, the Nazis decided to take us on a train after traveling in a cattle car, really, for days and days, till we wound up in Auschwitz. On my 16th birthday, May 28, 1944, is when I got off the train at Auschwitz. Right away, they threw my father to the right, which later finding out, straight to the gas chambers. I was still holding hands very strongly with my mom because she was crying that she was hiding from the Nazis an egg or two a week so she could make me a birthday cake. Never happened. Right away, as I say, they took my father to the right, and when the Nazis saw that I'm holding hands with my mom, they took our hands apart and threw my mom to the right also, which later finding out straight to the gas chambers. Never saw them again. And they took me to the barracks. When I was there for 3.5 months, tortured mercilessly, being beaten up every day. We had to kneel on rocks until blood was coming out because they had to count the woman, and many of us just went to the barbed wire because they couldn't suffer anymore. And the barbed wire was with electricity. But until they found them, they had to stay in line. Five women in one row, and until they were all counted. I was standing in line with four of my friends from my hometown. The youngest was my best friend. And one day, as we're standing in line, Dr. Mengele, I don't know if anyone knows him, was called the angel of death, stood in front of my line, and it looked to me he had this horrible silver cane that he pointed towards the woman that he wanted to take out. Of course, we didn't know where or what, but he took him away. And as we're standing in line to be counted, he stands in front of my line, and it looked to me like he's pointing this horrible silver cane at me. So I step out of the line, and he takes that horrible cane, pushes it into my belly button, and pushes me back to the line, and takes out my best friend, and takes her away. When we got back to the barracks, this mean couple, who was also Jewish, but they were looking to have a little bit more bread or something, so they were sometimes even more mean to us than the Nazis. And so this couple calls out, is that anyone in the that has a family that was taken away And the three remaining sisters says, yes, our little sister was taken away. And this mean couple hollers out, you see the chimney smoking? Meaning the gas chambers, this is where your little sister is. Up till today, I have such guilt feelings because I thought I was supposed to be there. And this went on for 3.5 months, being tortured so bad that sometimes I went to the barbed wire wanting to torture. I didn't want to suffer anymore. Then in front of me came my parents' faces, and I couldn't touch it. What if they're alive and I'm not? Wow. Which I believe very strongly, God put them in front of me. He had a purpose for me. And I believe that very, very strongly. In the meantime, after 3.5 months, they decided to take a woman, excuse me, to the labor camps. We didn't know where we were going, but they put an incredible heavy barrier in front of the barracks because it had no doors, and whomever they felt they could go to war, pushed them in, and whom not, they pushed away, later finding out straight to the gas chamber. Oh, I'm sorry. In the meantime, while in the barracks, I befriended a very nice woman, 2 years older than I, and we became like sisters. And when the Nazis decided to take women to the labor camp, they put an incredible heavy barrier in front of the barracks, because the barracks had no door. And whomever they felt they could go to work, pushed them in. And whom not, pushed them away, later finding out straight to the gas chambers. So as I was standing there, they pushed in my so-called sister. I was standing there and crying. Now I even lost my sister. As I was standing there and crying, this unbelievably heavy barrier fell over and I snuck into the barrack. By the time I snuck in, they already took my so-called sister away, but I was taken away to a different labor camp. And this is why I don't have a tattoo. I wasn't supposed to be here. But God had other plans for me. And so I was taken to a different labor camp in an ammunition factory. I was there for 9.5 months. Working 12 hours a day. Every 2 weeks the shift changed and I worked 24 hours. I was so exhausted that I soldered my fingers to the mines. So I don't even have fingerprints. But the United States was nice enough to give me a visa anyways. I could have been a criminal, but they thought different. And so I was in that labor camp for 9.5 months, working very hard work, and American soldiers started coming forward, so they took us what they called a death march, because many of us died on the road, no food, no water, just walking days and days, till we wound up in another labor camp, which is where I found my so-called sister. We were very, very happy, but the Nazis locked us in for 2 weeks until the American soldiers came, shut open the gate, and said, "You are free." Of course, we didn't understand a word English. We huddled together, terrified, until they found us a Jewish soldier, told us in Jewish, "You are free. And go into town and take whatever you like." I didn't want anything. I thought I'm gonna go home, find my parents, everything. But I picked up a big jar of honey. I licked it up with my fingers. By the time I got back to the camp, I was deadly ill. The soldiers took me to the infirmary. I was there for 4 weeks till they brought me back to health. And they called me the honey girl because I got sick from the honey. Years and years later, when my great-granddaughter was 2 years old, today she's 19 years old, my daughter took her to a 4th of July celebration. And my daughter came, and this little girl, 2 years old, had tears in her eyes. And of course she didn't know what it was going on, but she was very emotional. And my daughter comes home and tells me about it. And I says, "Will I ever tell you about my first 4th of July?" You see, the soldiers liberated us April 14, 1945, but they stayed there until September to bring us back to hell, because we were all like skeletons. So they celebrated 4th of July. I had no idea what they were celebrating, but I had tears in my eyes. And when my daughter comes home and tells me about my great-granddaughter, I tell her, did I ever tell you about my first 4th of July? And I end up telling her if I would ever meet an American soldier that liberated my camp, how happy I would be. My daughter got on the internet. She did not rest until she found me one. He lived in New Mexico near Albuquerque. When he heard about the Holocaust survivor, he got into his car. He was 89 years old by then. Got into his car, drove all the way to Phoenix to meet me. Yeah, this is my American hero, I call him. Yeah. And anyways, we became very good friends. We were going back and forth. He came to Phoenix. My son-in-law, may he rest in peace, took us to Albuquerque. One day we're sitting in his living room socializing. He looks at me and he says, "Esther, do you like honey?" I says, "Not anymore." And that is why I'm doing a documentary which is called The Funny Girl. Anyways,
Esther, what about, do you want to talk a little bit about, like, the other story? You've had so many miracles, I feel like, in your life, or the stars align, and maybe tell the story about, is it Brana, your friend?
Brana, yes. Brana? You see, when we were in the labor camp, we had a very good couple, and one day, we still had to stand in line for our food and to be counted. And so I'm standing one day in line for my food when a woman comes in front of me and I says to her in Hungarian, Ilonko, you already had your food. I see your bowl is dirty. And she says, well, yeah, but I'm still hungry. And we were arguing back and forth in Hungarian. When a Nazi came, she didn't know what we were arguing, but she decided to beat me up mercilessly. So bad that I had to crawl into my bunk bed and I couldn't get up next morning. But this good couple went to work for me and had to be counted, and so she saved my life. Her name was Brana, and years later, while we lived already in Brooklyn, New York, we were walking, my husband and I, on Coney Island Avenue, and all of a sudden we see a new bakery, and my husband says, let's go in, let's see if we can afford something. So we go in, and I holler out, Brana, and my husband hollers out, Brana. She lived in the same town where my husband was brought up. It was a real miracle. It was an amazing story. And so, we were going on like this for a long time. And it is...
Do you want to talk a little bit about how you met Joe after the war, what happened?
Yes. So, and it is after we were liberated, I was going home towards my hometown, but I had to get off the train at Budapest, the capital of Hungary, to take another train to my hometown, where the only cousin out of a family of 35 people that survived, only him and I that survived. And he was very happy to see me, but he says, Esther, no use for you to go home. Nobody survived. And the Russians even took over your house, so you know where to go. But we have an uncle in Palestine then, and I have a good friend who's taking orphans towards Palestine. And I'll introduce you to him, and he'll take you to Palestine and help you find our uncle, and he'll take care of you. I was 17, very naive, not knowing about the world at all. So I said, okay. He took me to his friend, who was 23 years old, and he took upon himself 60 orphans between ages of 12 and 18 to take towards Palestine. I was 17, So he took me along, and we fell in love right away. Before you know it, we were traveling a long, long time until we wound up in a displaced persons camp where the United Nations took care of us. And we realized it's going to take a long time till we get to Palestine, so we decided to get married in the displaced persons camp. And this is my wedding picture. The American soldiers gave us these jackets. They gave me a blanket because I was wearing jeans. A bride shouldn't wear jeans. So the girls in the organization sewed me a skirt. And the boys in the organization sold a ration of cigarettes for a month so they could buy me a piece of white material. A bride should wear something white. And so we got married in a displaced person's camp. Anyways, 3 months later, a woman next door got a bicycle. And I wanted to show my new husband that I know how to ride a bicycle. I get on the bicycle and I holler, "Joe, Joe." And Joe comes out. And when he comes out, I fell down, broke my knees, and they took me to the infirmary. I threw up right away. So the nurses tells me in German, "Are you pregnant?" I didn't understand a word. So they took me up to the third floor where there was a Hungarian doctor, and he tells me in Hungarian, "You're pregnant, right?" And I look at him and says, "Why? How?" He's looking at my finger. The United Nations gave us a very thin wedding band. And he looks at my finger and says, "You're married, right?" I says, "So?" He says, "So, that's why you're pregnant. What do you think you were doing?" I says, "I just thought I'm having fun." Anyways, when the kibbutz, the organization, realized that I'm pregnant, they made every effort to try to get me to Palestine. They didn't want the baby to be born in Germany. So they took us on a train. We wound up in Paris. And then from there we took a ship towards Palestine. We traveled for days and days because the ship broke very often, had to be fixed. But finally, we wound up at the port of Haifa. We already saw the lights. We already sang the Hebrew national anthem, the Hatikva. And as we are singing it, the British chorus took us off the ship by force and put us on another ship and took us to Cyprus. We were among the first ones to get to Cyprus. We had to build our own tent. There were 3 couples in one tent, 3 beds made of wood, really. And it was going down there for 6 months we were there, until the British decided to take 50 people every month to Palestine. And being I wasn't 18 yet and pregnant. We were among the first ones to get on the ship, and finally, we made it to Israel. We were very happy. 2 weeks later, my older daughter was born. And it was a wonderful, we were very, very poor. Hardly anything to eat, but we were very happy. We weren't worried about a policeman or anything. Although if we would have committed a crime, I know we would have been arrested. But they were my people. I wasn't afraid of anything. And this was going on for a couple of years until in 1948, when Israel became a nation, my husband and 3 of his brothers went into the army next day, and one of his brothers died. My father-in-law, who was already in Toledo, Ohio, a synagogue took him out. He was a rabbi. And so he was in Toledo, Ohio, and when he heard about his son, he sent us such sad letters. How sad it is to lose a child, which now I understand. I lost 2 children within the last 2 years. They were born 15 months apart, and they died 15 months apart. And so, anyways, my husband decided, Esther, we have to come to the United States. But we couldn't come straight. We had to live in France for 6 months till we finally got the Canadian visa. We lived there for 6 years. Till we finally got the American visa. That was in 1958. And so we left very happy. We had 58 wonderful years. And so he passed away. It'll be 20 years next month. It was a wonderful time. Yeah. Anything else?
Esther, talk a little bit about your life today. So you have such a rich life.
Yes. I have a wonderful life. I have a wonderful daughter. She was 77 2 days ago. And I live with her, you see. It took her years to convince me to go live with her. You see, I just didn't want to lose my independence. But finally, after years, 5 years ago, I decided to come to Prescott and live with her. And we have a very, very happy life. We go sometimes listen to music, dancing. All the young men are asking me to dance. And my daughter says, am I chopped liver? I guess. Anybody, so.
Are you still angry with the Germans?
Never, no. You see, when Steven Spielberg made that movie, Schindler's List, He took all the proceeds from that movie, send out people from Hollywood to Holocaust survivors who wants to make a tape of their life. And my husband and I made a tape. When the woman from Hollywood finished my story, she says, well, Esther, how do you feel about the Germans today? I says, well, I cannot forget the horror they put me through. but I can forgive. Because if I don't forgive, if I hold a grudge, I only hurt myself. This woman from Hollywood hugged me, telling me I was the first Holocaust survivor to answer her the question the way I did. But I believe it. You see, I don't have anything from my parents, not even a picture, nothing, but what they taught me. To be good, if you can't do anything good, don't do anything bad. Love all people, regardless of race or religion. Forgive, love God, think positive, and you'll have a happy life. And this is how I live my life, happily. Speak about it. Our children heard our screaming at night. They had no idea what will. My husband was in a slave labor camp also. And they both had terrible nightmares. They were screaming in the night. My older daughter thought there was something wrong about being Jewish, because she had no idea why we were screaming. But eventually it stopped. I still have nightmares now and then, but not anymore. Especially since I decided to speak, I have less and less nightmares.
Do you want to tell the story about how you started to speak? Your granddaughter invited Mark's.
Oh, yes. You see, my son, may he rest in peace, he was a mechanic, and he had a business, and he had a friend who worked for him. And one day, the friend's son comes home all excited. Dad, did you ever hear of Holocaust? He learned about the Holocaust. And his father says, yes, Mark's mom is a Holocaust survivor. He was so excited. Can we invite her to speak in our class? Of course I went. I was in Chandler, and ever since, and they sent me the most beautiful thank you notes, telling me, Mrs. Basch, we'll make sure it'll never happen again. And that kind of warmed my heart, and I decided, I was able to speak about it. more and more. Yes, darling.
How do you feel about the anti-Semitism that's on the rise now? How has that affected you?
I feel very, very sad. Very sad. Especially what's happening today in Israel. It makes me very, very sad. I wish I could do something. The only thing I can do is pray, and I'm doing that. Doing that every day. Yes.
What happened to your so-called sister? Did she come to the States also?
What happened to your so-called sister? Did she come to the U.S.?
Yeah, well, she was Romanian, and Czech people were among the first ones to take their Jewish people home. So I had to leave her in the camps. Yeah. But, yeah. And when I lived in Canada, this woman whom I was beaten up because of her, she lived in Canada next door to me. And one day I'm walking with, I already had three children by then, and I'm walking on the street and I see a woman holding herself and running. And I holler after her, Ilonka, where are you running? She says, you mean you're not gonna beat me up? I says, why should I? You were hungry, I was hungry, but now we have a belly full. And we became the best of friends. Yes. A lot of miracles happened to me in my life. A lot. Yes.
So you speak of forgiving others.
Yes.
What message do you have to the Holocaust deniers?
Well, the only message I could give them, think what you're doing. If you're gonna do something bad, it might come back to you. But if you are a good person, you're gonna live a happy life. And this is how I really feel, a happy life. Yes.
Have you gone back to Europe?
No. If they didn't want me there, I don't want to be there. The only dream I have to go back to Israel one more time at least. That's my dream. But I'll be 96 pretty soon. I don't know if I can take that trip.
Yes.
What did you think most about when you were in the camps? What was on your mind the most there?
When you were in the camps, what was on your mind in 16 and 17? What were you thinking about?
I was dreaming a whole day about seeing my parents again. And that kept me alive. You know how many times I went to the barbed wire because I didn't want to suffer anymore. I knew if I touch it, I won't suffer. In front of me came my parents' faces, and I couldn't touch it. But if they're alive, and I'm not. I feel very, very strongly God put them in front of me. I believe in God very, very strongly. I'm not so religious the way I was brought up, but I believe in God very strongly. If not for Him, I wouldn't be here. I wouldn't meet these wonderful people around.
Yes. question is, did you see any kind of factor or something that distinguished the survivors from the non-survivors? Is there anything?
Some, I met a lot of survivors who are very bitter of what they went through. And if I speak to them, I'm trying very hard to comfort them and tell them, have a happy life. Think of the future. Think of your children. And you'll have a happy life. That's how I live my life, happily. After what I went through, I feel now I just want to be happy, live my life.
Maybe you can talk about what Jewish life was like before the Nazis came in your hometown.
What was the Jewish life like in your hometown before the Nazis came?
It was wonderful. I never encountered anti-Semitism. I had Christian friends, I had Jewish friends, but when the Nazis came in, all of a sudden I'm a dirty Jew. The same Christian friends didn't want to have nothing to do with me. So I didn't want to have nothing to do with them, and that's why I never went back to my hometown.
God will take you out of there when you were in the camp.
When you were in the camp, did you believe that God would take you out?
Oh, yes, I did very strongly. You know, once in a while, they let us out of the barracks to walk the street. 99.5% of the women said, there is no God. How can he look down on this horror and do nothing? I never, ever thought for a moment. I always felt God has his purpose. And I believed him very strongly. And I felt he'll do something for me to make sure I'm here right now. Yes.
Why did the Jews go lambs to a slaughter? Why did they fight back and try to survive as opposed to just walking into the chambers and dying? Why did they fight?
The question is, why did people not fight back when you're being taken into the ghetto and into Auschwitz?
We were the minority, let's face it. And we were terrified. We were terrified.
Yeah, and they took, I mean, you had, like when you went into the ghetto, right, they said, I think she tells the story, what, you had one suitcase and a pillow, and
they
took everything.
Before they took us into the ghetto, they told us to take one suitcase and to take all the pillows and quilts. They went into the main synagogue in my hometown. When we got in there, the Nazis took all the pillows and all the quilts, tore them apart. The synagogue became like a snowstorm. Sometimes I still have nightmares about. They thought that maybe we had some jewelry or money or something, so they tore all the pillows apart. And that was a very traumatic thing for me. I still have nightmares about that, because it was unbelievable. Yeah.
Another question?
Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you so much for listening to me. It warms my my heart when I see how people care.
Can you share what life was like inside the ghetto?
What was life like inside the ghetto?
That was horrible, horrible. No food, hardly any water. It was very, very bad. Yeah. The worst part was when we had to watch, when we were watching our neighbors, taking our house apart, taking everything we had. The same neighbors that we were friends before the Nazis came in. We helped each other, you know, with the crap, with everything. And then all of a sudden we're the rituals. And that was no fun.
Do we have stuff questions? Yeah, okay. Inspiration.
Thank you.
An absolute legend. All I can say is you speak with such faith and with such joy that I'm hoping that this congregation doesn't offer you the job of taking over over here. But I have to say that we're all that much better from hearing from you. And some, you know, I was thinking some of the stories that you were saying probably could read in a newspaper, or I could read in a book, or an article about you.
Yeah.
But you know, the energy that you put into it, and the joy, and the love, and the message, and the positivity.
It
just to, you know, especially for all of us to hear what you endured and how you've come out of it, and your inspiring message is like.
It warms my heart when I see how people care. It gives me energy to continue what I'm doing.
Well, we care, and we have all ages over here. You see, have younger, teenagers, the older. So it's been incredible. Just want to say that we have tonight a tribute, a song. We researched which song is your favorite song.
Oh no! So, hallelujah!
I can't tell you. I can't tell you. You'll hear it, but I just want to say thank you on behalf of the whole community.